gamut. He served on staff there for the way for years, serving with God, been a pastor, and then has been a missionary, church planter. And God has used him mightily in that way, and then has been a very faithful pastor as well. And his position there is one of these. God has used this man. And I pray, been a very mission-minded church, as many churches itself. And it's a supporter of missions, and just a good friend of pastors and missionaries and preachers. And God has used him mightily in the life of this church and in my life and others. And so we are so thankful for him. He's preached it and he's lived it. And we're thankful for him, Sister Brenda. And ask Brother Jerry to come at this time and just give him liberty. That's your water right there. That's not the baptistry. That's the water.
I don't want to drink up your baptistry.
We got that water right out of the
floor. That's good. As long as it's wet. I don't see anything floating in it, so that's good. I do feel a little thirsty. I want to make all of you thirsty. I feel hungry too. It's a good thing for you. And I feel real special. It's amazing how much we feel, isn't it? Faith or feelings. The Lord gave us feelings. We're made in His image. He has feelings. And I felt real blessed to be able to participate in the offering. And so I really felt blessed when Brother Ron said, well, you could designate that offering. So I grabbed an envelope designated for the special speaker. Win-win. Thank you for the opportunity to be with you on one of your special days. You're a year of trusting God, and trusting God and not our feelings. And feelings are a wonderful thing. We have to have those feelings. And the problem we run into so often, though, is that we go with our feelings instead of our faith. And so we want to talk a little bit about that today. I'm going to be in the book of Habakkuk. That's the way I pronounce it. I know that's not the correct pronunciation of it, but hey, I do better on that than most of those Bible words, Bible names, so I'm getting close. I just can't add that little extra cut to it. Habakkuk. But we're going to look at that for just a little bit, but the Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, one of our favorite verses, and I want to interpret that verse according to our feelings today. And if I were to read that according to our feelings, I would read it with, but without feelings, it's impossible to please Him. You know, a lot of Christians run on emotions. A lot of movements, religious movements, are emotional driven. They're word driven. Faith-driven. But without faith, feelings, it's impossible to please Him, for he that comes to God must feel like that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently feel Him. Sometimes it feels so good when we feel Him, right?
Yeah.
And but when we put that in there, it just doesn't read right, does it? If we were to interpret Habakkuk 2:4, it would read, "Behold, his soul, which is filled up, is not, which is lifted up, is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his feelings." That doesn't read right, does it? If we were to interpret Ephesians 2:8, "For by grace are you saved through feelings." Yeah. And that not of yourself is God. Ephesians 2:9 says, "Not of works, lest any man should boast." But would have to read the other day about this lady. She was so busy. Her day was so full of appointments and things she had to get done. And she had a doctor's appointment, and she was at that doctor's appointment. You know how that goes. That run a little bit late. And they said, could you stay for the results of your lab work? And that took a little more time. And so she gets out of there, and they've given her a prescription. She's got to run by the drugstore and get her prescription filled. And she got to pick up her children from the babysitter and then get home and make dinner and then get to church that night. So she was really in a hurry, and so she pulled through the Walmart parking lot, and all of a sudden the heavens just opened up. And I mean, it began to rain. And I'm told that she normally doesn't ask God for small things, but she thought, well, this is a good time. So, Lord, you know, I'm really behind on my schedule, and you know I've got to get this prescription filled. And, Lord, it is really, you've opened up your heavens, and if you could just find me a little parking place right up close to the front so I don't get soaked, I would so appreciate it. And about that time, the backup lights came on the car in front of her, and right there, the closest parking lot, parking space next to the handicap, and they started to back out, and she said, never mind, Lord, I got this by myself. That's kind of how we are, isn't it?
I don't know.
We ask the Lord, and we're in our feelings and take credit for it when it comes. You know probably very well the narrative of Naaman, the mighty man and the captain of Assyria. He had a good life, except he had a problem, and it was leprosy. You know that story. That little maid that got carried over into work with his wife and for his wife. The little maid said unto her mistress, would God my Lord were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy. So that chariot, I can picture it, with the horses all lathered up, slides to a stop in front of Elisha's house. And old Naaman, he already had it figured out how it should work. And in the middle of that story, he says, behold, I thought.
Yeah.
You know, we can say, well, Naaman felt like. He said, I thought he will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and strike his hand over the place and be healed and recover the leper. Been watching too many TV bands. But what happened was this little no-name independent Baptist preacher come out and said, hey, the master said, go down there and wash in the river seven times and you'll be made clean. Man, Naaman would feel like that. He said, I've got rivers. I have two rivers at least back home. It would be a much better place to take a bath than this. And he went away, the Bible says, in a rage. He just didn't feel like that was what needed to be done. Now, if Naaman had followed that pathway of his feelings, he would have died an early death of that leprosy. But because he had enough faith to go down and dig, and it worked, and skin returned like a baby's. Amazing. You know, when we look at men of faith in the Scriptures, the people that God gives us in the Scriptures to demonstrate faith in their life, that faith is demonstrated in the face of great feeling. You remember Abraham being called upon to offer his son Isaac? Can you imagine the feeling and emotion that he had with that? And yet he went.
Amen.
If he followed his feelings, I'm sure that would be a different story. God blessed that. God always blesses faith. The only way you can please God is by faith.
That's true.
And I think of I think of Job sitting there for those months with all of those emotions running in his life and making some outlandish statements sometimes. He just wanted to talk to God. But when he got that audience, he didn't have much to say, did he?
Yes.
But he faithed that out, really. And God blessed him in that. I think of Joseph. All the emotions, the negative emotions. And yet, because Joseph trusted God, he said, "You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good."
Amen.
It's always best, and as Brother Ron said a little bit ago, it's a lot easier said than done. It's always best to fall to faith. Fall to faith. The scripture says here in Habakkuk, of course, Habakkuk was concerned. He had a deep burden that God was not disciplining the sins of Israel. He was trying to defend the holiness of God.
Yeah.
And listen, God doesn't need any defending in that area. He can hold his own with that.
Yeah.
But he was concerned, and that was good. This prophet was, he was more concerned about Israel's sins than he was the fact that God was going to use a wicked, perverse nation to discipline them. And he was going to bring in the Babylonians, the Chaldeans. God tells him this in this chapter. So back up, he begins to wait, and God speaks to him. Chapter 2, it says, "I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower and watch to see what he will say unto me, what I shall answer when I am reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, Write the vision and make it plain upon tables that he may run that reads. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie, though it tarry. Wait for it, because it will surely come, and it will not tarry. Behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith." It's an amazing thing. The Bible says we're called to trust God. It's one of the hallmarks of Christianity that we trust our God. As everything in the Christian life is built upon faith. We believe by faith that God created this world. Very strong tenet in our faith. But we're called to trust our God. And in trusting our God, we inevitably bring glory to our God. And that's the system that God has set up. He says, don't feel your way through life, but faith your way through life. Trusting me. We use the expression, the Christian life. We could just as easily say the Christian faith, because that's what it is. We're to be people of faith and trusting him. The just shall live by faith. You say, well, that's over in one of those minor prophets, but the Bible quotes that same quote in the New Testament three times. Paul quotes that verse in Romans 1:17 and the Galatians 3:11. Almost word for word, the just shall live by faith. The Lord said over there at the back, the just shall live by his faith. Paul quotes part of this judgment that's coming in Acts 13:41. Hebrews 11:6, but without faith it's impossible to please him, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, save that little word for just a little bit later, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. This prophet took that message to heart, because as we read through this book, We find that the third chapter, the last chapter of this book, we see this man's faith. He knew bad times were coming. Very bad times. And he knows that the things that he's talking about in this passage that I'll read for you, and you can read as well, that these things were going to happen. Everything was going to fail. In Habakkuk 3, 17, 18. 18 and 19. He says, there's six things that are going to fail here. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vines, the labor of the olive shall fail, the field shall yield no meat, the flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. There's his faith.
Amen.
I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord is my strength, and he will make my feet like hinds feet, and he will make me to walk upon mine high places, to the chief singer on my stringed instruments. Well, Bacchus, said, that'd make a good song. Set music to it, boys. We're going to sing that. Imagine you singing a lot. Because these things happen. That needs to be our song. And no matter what happens, we'll rejoice in the Lord.
Yes.
No matter if the... You know, we always, when we get news that we're not sure about the outcome, and we're always immediately go to the worst outcome, don't we? And the worst was going to become reality in this man's life. And so he decided ahead of time, this is going to be my commitment. I'm going to walk by faith. And that needs to be our commitment. We're called to trust God. And you know, the thing about it, our God is, this really shows how fallen we are. Our God is so trustworthy.
Amen.
Isn't he?
Amen.
I mean, he is so trustworthy. And he's the one we're called to put our trust in. Don't trust man. Praise God when you have someone alongside of you that's faithful, like your wife or your husband, and you have a good pastor that you can follow, but don't put your faith in us preachers. You know, we ought to live the way in such a way that you can, and because we're called to do that, be faithful and be trustworthy. But our God is completely trustworthy. Paul wrote to Titus concerning this thing about the eternal life that he's given us. He says, in hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie, I like that, promised before the world began. You know, God's care for us is constant. Even when we're not aware of it, God is caring for us. He's taking care of us. He urges us, and he exhorts us to cast all of our care upon him because he cares for us. But in the book of Hebrews, chapter 13, 5 and 6, these were people that were being persecuted for their faith. And some being driven back to Judaism because their faith was not strong enough, evidently. And that's that whole letter of Hebrews encouraging him to stay with Jesus. He's superior than anything. All of these other things that you had in Judaism in the Old Testament were pictures and examples of him. And stay with Christ. He's better than. And all of those things. And he writes, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have, for he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. And this was written to people undergoing great persecution. And it seems like the Lord says, am I not enough for you? I want to be enough for you. One of my good friends, I think Brother Ron knows him, Brother Russell Little, a member of our church. Russell, oh, that man has gone through, I couldn't tell you what. Oh, he had two little boys, his wife left him, I mean just deserted him, went off into a world of drugs, never came back. Self-employed. Got in trouble with the IRS. Could never satisfy them. I mean, you know, it seems when they get you down, they just keep kicking. I don't know how many penalties he paid and trying to make things right. And I mean, he would get so discouraged and trying to raise those two boys. And the devil was getting in the midst of that. And just get so, he would call me and we would talk.
and just try to encourage him, and just weep, and I remember he went through a siege of just, I mean, so low, so discouraged, and he called me, and he was upbeat, and he said, Pastor, I've experienced something I never thought I would experience. And I said, what's that, Russell? He said, you know that song about when all you have is Jesus, you find out that Jesus is all you need. He said, I have found that. I've experienced that. And that's what God is telling us. I am what you need, and I am all you need. Now, God puts other things into our life that he knows that we need, but they're based upon him. He puts a New Testament church in our life because we need that.
Amen.
He's put a Bible in our lap because that's what we need. And all of these things, but ultimately, he is all we need.
Right.
So God's care is constant, and you can trust him.
Amen.
He loves you. He's proven that over and over and over, but ultimately, supremely, he's proven that by sending his son, Christ. Amen. So, God's care is constant. God's gifts are generous. Amen. Wow. Romans 5, 20 and 21. Paul says, more with the lawyer that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. That if sin had reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. Now that was written to us who are was under such great condemnation. I mean, isn't that a generous gift that God would send his son? That where sin abounded in our life, his grace abounded much more. His grace overtook that, that we might appear righteous to a holy God. That's amazing that it's like that. So our God is completely trustworthy. We can trust him. God's love is unconditional. This is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Amen.
You know, what more does God have to do to show us he's trustworthy and worth trusting? He's promised, and he's proven good to his promises. This promise that was made before the foundation of the world. In the fullness of time, that Savior was presented.
Yeah.
And did his work on the cross so that we might be saved. How many times has God ever let you down? I can't think. I think of a lot of times where I didn't trust God, but God has never let me down. Never, ever, never. Many times in the smallest of details. Sometimes, you know, we're so far off the mark sometimes, and many times we have to look back at what he sees instead of living in the midst of what he's doing.
Yeah.
My mind is filled with things that I know and remember my God seen through. God never lets us down. Never. How many times has God come through for us? Many, many, many times. God has been there for us. Always, always. He's always shown himself strong on our behalf. Which brings us to the rub in life, and that is, how do we walk by faith? How do we live our faith? Well, Habakkuk says, the just shall live by his faith. He brings it into not only a personal responsibility, but a personal privilege of living by faith. God very simply in that verse, and boldly states that the unjust person, the prideful person, is doomed because of his trust in himself. But the just shall live by faith. Saved will live by his faith. His faith in his God, our faith in our God, my faith in my God. And so it takes a personal commitment to living by faith, to trusting God, a personal commitment to our God, and take those steps to follow wherever he leads us. You know, the biggest problem I've had, I don't know about you, in walking by faith is the fear. And the worry that comes through that fear. I remember very distinctly, just like it was yesterday, of dealing with, as a new Christian, the call to preach. God put us in a good church and brought us immediately into contact with, as I look back, really great preachers. They were not known to the world, but they were great preachers, great men that lived by faith, very humble men. And I admired that. I said, that's what I want to be. And our pastor was a good man of God that probably because of where we were at in our life, I mean, we were soaking up everything we could. I mean, we hung on every word. We heard him and looked at the Bible and, oh, that's what that means. Well, yeah, that fits there. Yeah. Okay, I understand that. And we were just soaking that up. And I remember God calling me, and my problem was, do I just want to be like these men? I mean, I wanted to. My problem was I didn't want to. But I wanted to, I had learned enough that I needed to be of God. So I knew that if I was being called to preach, it had to be God calling me to preach. And I remember we were working on a building at church, an educational building, and my pastor was, I got there after work, and some were already there working, and he was laying tile, and I went in there and started laying tile with him, and I'm sure he knew why I was in there. And I said, Brother Hodges, how did you know God was calling you to preach? Nobody's ever asked me that question, I'm sure. I've been asked that a lot since then. And he just stopped, big tall guy, slender guy, put it back up against the wall, drew his knees up, and he said, now, feller, I can't tell you whether God's calling me to preach or not. You're just going to have to figure that out on your own. He said, I will pray for you, and you'll know. And I remember after wrestling with that for 2 or 3 months, I guess, and I remember God settling that in my heart. And I remember going forward in a Bible conference that our church had on a Saturday night. And I went forward over the knowledge that God called me to preach. There were several others that come, and some had been saved, some were coming for baptism. So he presented those to the church, and he asked me to come. He said, Brother Jerry says, God's calling you to preach. And how many of you have been praying for him about that? Hands went up everywhere. And he said, now, Brother Jerry, I didn't tell anybody. Oh, man. I mean, the first time that they asked me to give a devotional in church, before, I mean, it took months for me to agree to do that. And they tricked me. Because one of my friends that I grew up with was in that church, and he was very, probably more introverted than me, and I'm pretty introverted. And so the Sunday school superintendent said, he kept asking me, I said, Jim, I just can't do that. He said, well, pray about it. I said, well, no use praying about it. I can't do that. And he said, well, if I could get Lloyd Morrow to give one, would you give one? I'm thinking, that's a sure deal. I would if he would. I'd like to see him do that. And he said, well, he's giving one next. When I got to church for Sunday school, I had to go to the restroom and throw up.
Sunday morning after I had been known. I was called to preach. The first thing I woke up was, what have you done? What have you done? What are you going to do? Oh, man. You know, fear holds us back.
It does.
And it helped me back on a number of things that I thought I couldn't do. But I found out. And God will help me with that.
That's it.
And it's always that way. God's way is always the best way.
Amen.
Trust Him in all things and always acknowledge Him that what the earth is right. And do that. So it takes a personal commitment to trust Christ and take those steps. It also takes a personal knowledge of God's Word, because faith comes by hearing.
Yes, sir.
Romans 10:17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And so you must know if faith is what you're calling faith is leading you in the right way. It has to be confirmed by the Scripture.
Right.
And so when you have it confirmed, then do it.
Amen.
Or stop doing it, whatever the case may be. It also calls for a personal prayer life that seeks God's will and not our own will. After all the countless numbers of books and seminars and podcasts and Bible conferences on prayer, the Scripture still simply says, Lord, teach us to pray. And He says, okay, here's how you pray. After this manner. After this manner. Therefore pray you, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. And so a personal prayer life seeks not our will, but God's will. And then it takes a personal commitment to the kingdom of God, because He says, but seek you first the kingdom of God. And all these things, and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And so if we're seeking to walk by faith, we must be willing to commit ourselves and become people of prayer, people of the kingdom, and be available to populate the kingdom of God through our witness, because He is the King, our kingdom. He's the one that has come to seek and save that which is lost. And His goal is to bring people into His kingdom, translate us out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. So that's part of our learning how to live by faith. Just in closing, not only do we have the challenge of walking by faith, but we have the privilege of walking by faith. Only the just, only the saved can live by faith. You know, we're the only ones that have the promises. And it's not the most famous, it's not the most powerful, not the most intelligent, but it's the just. The just shall live by his faith. And the privilege it is. It's a life of faith for none other than you. The least of us here today can walk by faith.
Amen.
Just simply, believe me, I think that's why the Lord said we need to have faith like a child. You know, if we're not careful, we try to get people saved like adults. But He says we need to get them saved like a little child. He said, unless you become like a little child, you won't be converted. And so, we're to have that childlike faith, and we're privileged to have that. We're to walk with God, if we can, by faith. We can partner with Him by faith. And, you know, we commit our fortune and our future to Him by faith, and that's what it is. And we commit it to a God who's as someone said, too wise to err, too good to be in. Listen. It may not look like it when you're walking by faith, but you're going to come out on the top.
Amen.
You're going to come out victorious.
Amen.
You're going to come out because the Bible says you're more than a conqueror. Walk by faith. The righteous and God-dependent, the just are immortal and indestructible in the Lord. Those who live by faith find resources that are inexhaustible. Right?
The Bible teaches us that there were people that gave beyond their ability in the Scriptures. Gave beyond their ability to give. That's amazing. That's amazing. You know, the Scriptures tell us in Ephesians 3:20, and it's applicable to those who live by faith, because we can dream big dreams, impossible dreams that God gives us, and we can see those realized through our faith in God, because the Scripture says that He is able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. I think that power is probably a dual power. It's the power of the Holy Spirit, but it's also our faith that works in us. And finally, from the book of Habakkuk, a scathing rebuke of Israel's idolatry in chapter 2, verse 18, 19, and 20. He says, "What profit the graven image?" And this was their, this was Israel's great sin in all of her life, was idolatry. This sin of idolatry brought about the greatest chastening of the Lord in their life. It's brought about their captivity and back into slavery and made it hard for them until they could come out from under that, until they would repent. It's idolatry, putting things in the place of their God. And listen, we may not have a little statue that we bow down to every day, but we have other things. And maybe we may not be recognized, but we know what they are that keeps us from our worship of the true God and our trust in the best God and the only God, the living God of Israel. And He's our God. And so He's giving a great rebuke here, and it's almost comical. He says, "What profit the graven image that the maker thereof hath graven it? The molten image and a teacher of lies, that the maker of his work trusteth therein to make dumb idols. Woe unto him that saith to the wood, Awake, to the dumb stone, Arise, it shall teach. Behold, it is laid over with gold and silver, and there is no breath at all in the midst of it." And he makes a contrast here. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. I think that verse there is akin to what Paul said in Romans 3:4, "Let God be true and every man a liar." But God is in his holy temple. Didn't say he was, didn't say he will be, says he did. He is a present God. When you have him, there's no past tense with him. It's all I am that I am. A present tense God. He's been in his holy temple. Not will be, but is. He's always wanted his people to know that he's real. That's why he sent Jesus. He declares that. God has always wanted his people to know that he is present. That he's with us. And he is. God has always wanted his people to know that he is ready to bless. He rewards those that diligently seek him. That believe that he is. That should be us. God has always wanted you and me to know that he could be trusted and he can be. There may be some here today that your faith maybe has wavered a little bit, maybe driven you off into fear, to worry, to doubt. Why don't you just reaffirm that trust today in your heart that, "God, I do trust you." You might have to be like that father that Jesus encountered. That child needed a touch from Christ. So, do you believe? He said, "I believe." Oh, Lord, help my unbelief.
Amen.
You know, we're like that a lot of times. We know we need to believe. We should believe. We can believe. But also recognize that we're weak in those areas. And so, you might want to reconfirm that faith today. There may be someone here today that needs to touch your first faith. Christ Jesus. He can save.
Amen.
He will save. You believe in your heart. Christ died for you. He rose again. You put your faith in him. savable material, a sinner. So repent of your sin, put your faith in Jesus Christ, who is Savior.
Yeah.
So you could be saved today. You can start that life of faith. It's a supernatural faith. It's not positive thinking.
Right.
Positive results, but it's not positive thinking. It's not believing to the point where you can believe. It's just having enough faith to believe what God says is a big deal. Let's stay together. Folks, come to prepare for an invitation song. Would you bow your heads with me for just a moment? Father, we thank you so much that you have made a way, made a plan. It originates with you, that we can trust you and be saved. And that we can believe you and be blessed. And that we can walk by faith and do all the things that you've called us to do. And though we don't know how, we don't see it, we can believe it. So I pray for this congregation today, if there's one here that needs to reaffirm their faith and their walk with you, possibly some things that are going on in their life. Today's the day that they trust you. I pray you'll help them do that. Lord, if there's one here today who needs to be saved, I pray you'll prompt them. I pray that you will touch their hearts, that they will be convinced in their heart that you love them and that your son died for them, that they could be saved today. They would call upon you. Father, you